To start this video, I just want to briefly define what we mean by cellular respiration. This is a process by which the three carbons of pyruvate are oxidized to CO2, and the electrons we get from that process are transferred ultimately onto oxygen to make water. And the reason we do these electron transfers is to phosphorylate ADP to make ATP, which of course is a very important molecule to provide energy to cells. So physiological respiration will provide the oxygen and remove the carbon dioxide, but cellular respiration is this biochemical process, and that is really going to be the focus of the next remainder part of this topic, plus the next topic in the course. Now, the oxidation of pyruvate occurs in two steps. The first one is a conversion of the three carbons of pyruvate into acetyl-CoA and CO2, which is not shown right here. And then the acetyl-CoA goes on to further oxidation in the citric acid cycle. And you can see that some of the products of this are reduced electron carriers, NADH and QH2. So the rest of this video, I'm going to talk about decarboxylation of pyruvate. So the net reaction for this process is shown here. You've got three carbons on pyruvate. One of those is fully oxidized to CO2, and the electrons are transferred to NAD+ to make NADH. The remaining two carbons of pyruvate are transferred onto coenzyme A to make acetyl-CoA, the structure of which I showed in the previous video. Now, this reaction is catalyzed by an enzyme called pyruvate dehydrogenase, which is a very complex enzyme. It's got 60 different polypeptide chains and multiple enzymatic activities happening to make this process work. We're not going to go into all the detail of that, because I'm more interested in the position of this reaction in metabolism and how it's regulated. Having said that, this is a really important reaction because it represents a borderline sort of between carbohydrate metabolism represented by pyruvate and fatty acid metabolism represented by the acetyl group. Acetate is really a two-carbon fatty acid. And so this reaction, by accomplishing this reaction, the enzyme, the cell is crossing from carbohydrate metabolism into fatty acid metabolism. And many organisms, including mammals, do not have a way to go from lipid metabolism back to carbohydrate metabolism, meaning that it's impossible for us to convert lipids into carbohydrates in a net sense. And so this is a very important reaction to regulate because by doing this, the cell is committing itself to converting basically carbohydrates into lipids. And so the regulation of this enzyme is accomplished by phosphorylation, where the phosphorylated form is less active than the dephosphorylated form. And just to remind you, the phosphorylation is carried out by an enzyme called a kinase. And then there's also a phosphatase that'll specifically dephosphorylate the enzyme. And then which form of pyruvate dehydrogenase is prominent in the cell depends on cellular conditions, as you probably could predict based on what we've talked about before. So it turns out that the presence of insulin in the bloodstream, which represents high blood glucose, or the buildup of pyruvate in the cell are going to promote activity of the phosphatase to dephosphorylate the enzyme and activate this pyruvate dehydrogenase enzyme. And this makes sense because both of these compounds here represent a condition where you've got lots of starting material for this reaction. And so the cell is going to want to use that starting material for an effective purpose, as shown in this reaction. And conversely, the products of the reaction, acetyl-CoA and NADH, are going to favor activity of the kinase and phosphorylate this enzyme to inactivate it, because when you have a lot of products building up, that's not a good time to carry out the reaction, and we're going to want to inhibit it. And keep in mind that the effects of these compounds are not necessarily direct on the kinase or phosphatase, but there's going to be some sort of a signal cascade that's probably indirect to accomplish phosphorylation or dephosphorylation of the enzyme. And finally, acetyl-CoA and NADH, the two products, are competitive inhibitors of the enzyme. So again, as they build up, they're going to tend to slow down the activity of the enzyme. And that should just make logical sense. So for the exam, you should just understand why this reaction will proceed and under what conditions, rather than memorizing specific details here. So in the next video, I'm going to carry on and look at how the two carbons on acetyl coenzyme A are oxidized in the citric acid cycle.